Fair flyer, so I think he should be watched.
We're just about ready to go. The 5 second board's going up. The revs are going up to 8,000 RPM, where the limited bridge gets a lightning start. And then
Brabham stands still.
So Brabham's got troubles at the bottom. The others are going to move away. The Taylor cars stood still as well. You can see Anthony Taylor standing still there next to the recovery unit. As Bridge goes away, Aberdeen is back to third spot. As they go down through the total curves and make their way up through National Corner. Taylor's getting pushed into action. He's just down in front of our commentary box. Oh, and we've got a man losing it. Number 19 has lost it. Marco de Santos, that's a South African former GTI champion, has lost it. They might have got a tip, but that has caused a lot of problems as Taylor gets away. And then we go Duncan Foss, the Charlie Cox car in Class B, doing very well. Had gearbox go, and they changed the gearbox in something like 25 minutes. He started from the pit lane. But in the front, Aberdeen has now taken one place. He's got in front of the Sean van der Linde motor car. So Aberdeen now has got something to prove. Michael Briggs is on a roll. He's in the front, and he's charging that vector. Here we go. Did he get tipped? We don't know about that. It's Anthony Reid coming through just behind him. He gives him a little nudge on the way. It's very heavy down there. Reid had to start from the back of the A-class grid, and that is definitely number 19 out of this race. Marco de Santos, you do not get out of the stand, is out of this event. That's a great pity. He's sharing that car there with Google the German. It's Briggs in the front. Then it's Chris Aberdeen in the car that won the first race. That's the World Championship winning car, the exact vehicle, in fact, the Frank Bieler car. Heavy onto brakes, you can see blue smoke. Thought Van Linden is having it out there with the first of the Nissans.
That's Janiel de Villiers. And he came in, coming under a lot of pressure there from one of the BMWs. Not quite sure who it is. But a very bad start from David Brabham. So we can see him fighting to try and recover. But there goes Sean van der Linde. And there was a lot of confusion at the start of the race. Both Brabham and Anthony Taylor stood still. Anthony Reid, of course, was trying to come up from the back of the grid, and he then got held up. So really a very confusing start, but Mike Briggs really going excellently. Now the ball is in Aberdeen's court. Can he catch him, and can he pass him?
And Anthony Reid has come up unbelievably from 15th spot on the grid. He's now lying in 9th position overall, and we'll start getting into the picture. Oh, we've got problems here. We'll see which car that is. It's one of the Nissans, either Janiel de Villiers or Tiff Nadell.
That's Tiff Nadell. I can see the orange helmet, which is familiar to me. Bad luck, Tiff. But that car looks as though it's in a very exposed position.
It is. That's the car that actually, Lichterval hit oil in the first race, went off into the kitty litter, and that's where he stayed. That's Tiff Nadell, a very experienced driver in all forms of motor racing, Formula One, sports cars, Tim Top cars, the lot. And Aberdeen chasing off to break. Getting away in his own. De Villiers in third spot. Then it's Sean van der Linde. Vincent Foss there. The Rothmans Audi. He's sharing that with Terry Moss, as he did in the 24-hour race in Belgium. This young Belgian driver is a charger, as you're going to see shortly. Mike White is in sixth position. They finished one lap through halfway through the second lap. Craig Baird, the New Zealander, is up in seventh. He's in the Sabine Red car. Then we've got David Brabham from that disaster start. His eighth, Brian.
We have indeed, but now just watch the Audi, because it seems to be closing on Mike Briggs. And as we see there, the battle further down the field between Sean van der Linde, Vincent Voss, and Mike White, I think, just there as they go through the right-hander. Mike Briggs certainly will need to watch out, because the Audi is closing on him. Back here, we've got the Anthony Reid Opel Vectra, which is climbing like a rocket up through the field up tonight, looking for more.
Just have a look at the speed as we look at the Opel pit giving their signals to their man up in the front. There's Michael Briggs, and then on his trail we've got Chris Aberdeen. He's 0.5 of a second behind, half a second behind. Brabham is now, Sean Finland is up in sixth. Brabham is still in ninth position after that lap. That's two laps are gone. We've got 10 laps to go. We're talking about 42 k's in this race. But Aberdeen is now starting to close, and as we've seen in the first race, they can get very late with that motor car, very late into the motor car, into the corners. They can brake late, they go up to the apex of the corner, and they get the power on early.
And Chris Aberdeen, he really wants a win here. So Mike, the South African champion, is certainly going to have to defend mightily if he's going to hold off this challenge for the whole race. I don't see how he can do it, frankly. Look at him right on the tail there of Mike Briggs' Vectra.
Well, one determined Briggs, that you can make sure of, that he can get as aggressive as anybody. He'll defend his line. There's no doubt about it. He's been an old hand about it. He is the South African touring champion this year. He won it at the initial year, the debut year of touring cars in South Africa in 1993. That's Peter Lance now. back in the pits. They've got some problems. Probably a gearbox has gone. These cars are under great stress as Briggs lines it up to go through the Helvellyn sweep onto the brakes. Now he's got to defend his line very late there. Aberdeen's going. You see how late he can come. That four-wheel drive Quattro, that's the latest high-tech car, 95 motor car. Basically, the Briggs car is a 94 car with a 95 motor. Just behind them, we've got Janiel de Villiers. They're putting in a tremendous trot in that Nissan. Nissan back in touring car racing next year. They're talking about them maybe getting a Primera, but this car now, of late since they've made some mechanical and suspension changes, has done a great job of work. De Villiers doing it too. He comes through now. The gap was 0.5 of a second. It's 0.51 now. He's opened up by 0.1 to 0.01. It doesn't matter. He can see him ahead, and that's where he wants to be. They're into the traffic already. Some of the slow starting other cars. That's one of the
motorsport cars.
The imported cars. We've got three imported cars. One of them is at Audi, and of course the two German cars looking both look like that. It's lovely to have them in this country. It's Briggs now. This gives him time to check his mirrors. He goes across the old start-finish line. Not far behind the Janiel de Villiers. And Reed has gone off with Craig Baird. He's got up there. Craig Baird, Reed had got up to eighth. Craig Baird was seventh. And those cars, and that is where they are going to stay. Well, that's a great pity for them, brother.
That's a disappointment because I felt that we were going to see much more of the New Zealand champion in this race. But it looks as though they may have had something of an altercation coming together. We didn't see the start of the action, but... Craig Baird will be very disappointed.
And one of the problems when they get into that kitty litter, very often they can't get started against the battery to keep the weight down, just trying to swing those high compression motors.
It's not a good idea to start them anyway, because the trouble is the gravel gets everywhere and it can lead to engine failures. So it's almost better to sit there and wait to be pulled out, because there's another race to come. It's not as though the afternoon is over yet.
It's Michael Briggs and Aberdeen. They are now just on 3.5 seconds ahead of de Villiers. There he is, being followed there. And Foss has got up to fourth spot, as you see. A great drive through the field. There is Mike White just behind in the Toyota Camry, that Minolta one. Then it's Sean van der Linde. And that is the other car that started that. They had the gearbox trouble with Charlie Cox, the Aussie out of the UK. Now he races there now. That's the championship-winning B-class car. And another one's gone out. Hein Lardekon's gone out too. So those B-class cars are really under pressure at the moment. It's Aberdeen and got ahead of Briggs, according to our time. No, it's Briggs back in Aberdeen. We had a little flick on our timing monitor, and it said there that Aberdeen was on top, but as they came through, it just changed back. It's 0.3 of a second. It was 0.5. As you don't have to tell how close he is, he's a car length behind, and he gets the power on very quickly. Nothing wrong with the acceleration on that Opel, though.
It's got to be done in the corners, because as we've already heard from Frank Bieler, in straight line speed, the Audis don't really have much to answer the Opel Vectras, but of course they've got very impressive cornering ability.
At the, I heard him say they do about 203 k's an hour, and the Briggs car 205.
Yeah.
So it's really, it's the power out of corners and the speed down the straight. We've had four laps of this race. We're halfway through lap number five, and we've got a change of order. Aberdeen has gone to the front ahead of Michael Briggs, and it could be all over bar the shouting. It's up to Briggs now to show his aggression, but that Audi is so capable. That's the latest technology you get in the world there, and a really dedicated bunch of Audi engineers have put in a tremendous bit of designing and preparation of that car.
This has all sorts of implications for the British Touring Car Championship next year, because remember, we're seeing Frank Bieler racing the Audi A4, and so people like John Cleland and David Brabham and those guys who are racing the British Touring Car Championship are going to be fully aware of the size of the challenge from this mighty Audi. Here we see them going past now, and it's almost as though Mike Briggs left the door open. He certainly went out wide there, side by side. He certainly didn't leave it open there. And Chris Aberdeen forcing the advantage home, and Mike Briggs having to give way. In a way, there was almost a degree of inevitability about that. Oh. I didn't really feel that Mike could hold off the Audi for 12 laps.
And the other thing is, Aberdeen is certainly showing the other bit of aggression. There goes the mirror of Briggs' car. He took a mirror off as they went round there. Touched his brakes as he's running out of road. He didn't want to get onto the kitty litter as the others come through. The order have we got at the moment? We're on lap number six at the moment. After lap five, Chris Aberdeen was leading by 1.2 seconds. De Villiers has got Foss on his tail. A little bit further back, there's Mike White with Sean van der Linde. Mike White back in racing, raced in the Ayrton Senna days. Very experienced driver, spends his life tuning Toyotas, in fact, and putting a lot of horsepower into them. And have a look who's just arrived on the scene there. David Brabham is in business. He had that terrible stall at the start. He was back into ninth. He's come up to seventh, and he started to haul in Sean van der Linde.
He has indeed, and so this is an interesting battle for the South Africans versus the, well, I nearly said Europeans. He was born in Wimbledon, but let's face it, he's Australian. And so David with a point to prove, I think, just that he is quick, and remember that he's got another opportunity later on this afternoon. For me, the performance that's impressed me so far is Vincent Vos. In number eight, the other Audi, he's going very well. Mike White is just behind him. Then we have Sean van der Linde there going through Wesbank with an ever-closing Brabham. Anthony Taylor, I see, is up to ninth in the Toyota, but he was another victim at the start.
Foster started to get away. He's actually got Janelle Dumas. We'll pick that up a little bit later. And Brabham, very much in evidence, has closed there right onto van der Linde's tail. And these drivers are starting to push it as hard as they can. They're getting ragged there onto the dirt. They are not letting a little thing go. Just behind them is got Henny Groenewald. He just came second in the GTR race a little bit earlier in the afternoon. Henny Groenewald in car number 20, which is a Volkswagen Vento, doing very well amongst this sort of company. Here comes Brabham now. Brabham in number two. Sean van der Linde, the leading Enviro car there. They're just holding on to Mike. It's brave stuff to go down through that corner there, the total curve, flat out. You can just see they go to the edge of the road, and then you're into Nashua. Now you've got to go down through the box about three gears. You've got to brake, and then you've got to, the camber's against you, and then you've got to accelerate. It's a very, very busy corner. We've got de Villiers starting to close on Michael Briggs. John Clement was saying after the first race that he was having a few problems with the pickup. The car had missed a bit. The pickup in the tank wasn't getting all the fuel out of the tank. He felt like he's running out of gas. This might be happening to Michael Briggs. Could be happening because he's lost his toe from Aberdeen, and he's got de Villiers within striking distance.
Very interesting, the speeds, the relative speeds, because Chris Aberdeen is lapping in 146s. He's only about 0.1 of a second slower than Frank Wheeler earlier today. And all of the others are lapping in the 47s, 48s. So that demonstrates just the immense power and drivability of the IDA4. So Chris moving away a little bit now from Michael Briggs. But then Janelle de Villiers impressing me. He's a good young man, this. And I reckon South Africans got another star there.
I think the other team's also very grateful, Brian, that it's not raining this afternoon. And then we'd see that Audi dominate. I mean, it's awesome, that four-wheel drive that they've got in the cars. But there's a front-wheel drive Opel, we've got rear-wheel drive BMW, we've got a whole mixture there. The four-wheel drive actually weighs a little bit more than the other car, so there is a disadvantage there. Onto the brakes, down the PG order, got straight into the Gestetner corner. That is de Villiers. He's lying third at the moment. He's starting to close. You see the gap. He's closing on Briggs. No doubt about it. You can see him. It's evident now as he's come down a second. As we look back and see those others, there's de Villiers. Great trotty. Of course, he dominated in standard group N racing. He won at Class D, then he moved up to B, and it actually did very little racing, Brian. His early racing days, he used to just get in the front and clear off. Then he got into this racing, and they've developed that motor car, and it's become a real force, that little BP Nissan.
Very interesting to note that we have three South African drivers at the head: Chris Aberdeen, Mike Briggs, and Janelle de Villiers. Then Vincent Vos in fourth place on the eighth lap of this Air Glickcare touring car race. But David Brabham up to sixth, and no doubt trying very hard as they go through the left-hander to get past Mike White in the Toyota Camry. The two Envirocar BMWs there. But it's Brabham who's got the advantage over Sean van der Linde. Now, can he find a way past Mike White? I remember Mike White in the days when he raced back in the UK. And he was always a very hard competitor there. Certainly never gave up easily. So I don't think that David's going to find it easy to get past him today.
He's a great all-rounder, this Brabham. He's 30 years old, and we've seen him driving in Formula One, that type of thing. So to swap from single-seaters of that magnitude and into a tin top like this, and suddenly he would have been far further up the field. He's going for White now. He's very late on the brakes. He gives him a tip, uses the grass. Going to hold his line. Nothing wrong with that.
And that was beautifully done.
Lovely stuff. And look who's clipped through the meantime. Sean van der Linde says, you find it out on the side there in the ropes, and I'm going through the inside. And he's moved up two places. Can you believe it? That's opportunist driving there by Sean van der Linde. Won the Touring Car Championship in 1994. Comes from a famous family. His father, Henny, I think he had 56 wins in a row in that modified racing. This is the Toyota team hanging it out there for Mike White. The order after eight laps. We've got four laps to go as this battle goes on now for fourth spot. It's actually going on for fifth spot. We got in the front. Aberdeen is now nearly 5 seconds ahead of Michael Briggs in the Opel, Aberdeen, of course, in the A4 Audi. De Villiers is third in the BP Nissan. Fourth is Vincent Foss, the Belgian, going very well. He shares the car with Terry Moss. He's a talented driver, and here they come for each other again. Now Mark West says, I can't allow these BMWs to be in front of me. So he's going to get aggressive. We've got four left. We're going to do it. That's just about 17 kilometers of this race left, Brian.
Brabham's the meat in the sandwich here, because he can't really concentrate on getting past his teammate, Sean van der Linde, because Mike White is there. He's right with him. He's crawling all over the back end. And now it's changed. Has it?
Brabham again. He's got it happened around the Nature corner. I think it was out, we were outside today. But that's where it happened. He's got back again. Brabham now really wants to clear off. He wants to get, he's got himself up into fifth spot. Foss, I think, is too far ahead. Is he? You can see him going down the mine shaft just on the far side of the circuit out of West Bank corner. So Foss, I think, is established. He's not making much ground on the Villiers now. Seems to settle down to about 2 seconds behind. But here we are. Hyland de Villiers is right on his tail. Michael Briggs has got to defend his line. He might be having the same problems that Cleland have, not picking up all the fuel out of the fuel tank. They've got a fuel cell in that motor car, and there's still fuel in the tank at the end of the race, but it starts to stutter a wee bit out of corners and makes it difficult to drive. Can't hear it above all the noise. They're up to 8,000 RPM, six speed gearboxes. They're just over 900 kilos. Now that's lighter than most cars on the road. They're stripped of all the weight. Very sophisticated aircraft. In fact, Brian, these cars are all wrong for racing. The wheels are too big. They're tucked under the mudguard, as you can see there. If they lose it there, they haven't got a turning circle. They've got a couple of millimeters to be able to turn them. The power is tremendous for a chassis. It was never designed for it. So, I mean, they provide great racing, but they're actually all wrong for it.
Well, in a way they are, but of course, underneath that shell, they're much more a racing car now than they used to be. And certainly that is applying to the latest models, the 95 cars. And you heard what we said about the Audi yesterday. I mean, it's really a racing car, front suspension on the Audi. And it handles like a racing car, or more like a racing car than in the old days. An excellent performance from Janiel de Villiers here. It really is coming good and crawling all over Mike Briggs, but he's got to find a way past fairly quickly. We're on lap 10, so he's still got a bit of chance, but the young guy is proving that the South African champion is not invincible. He's going to give it his best shot. Vincent Voss not that far behind in fourth place in the Audi now, but where can Janiel do it as they come?
Briggs is an old stage, and he's certainly got the pressure on him as they go past on the B-class clock. Just to put you in the pictures, the two defend each other. Briggs is holding him out there. Briggs has definitely got some sort of problems after that tremendous start holding off that Audi. Here comes de Villiers now, going to get through the inside of Gesetner. They break down the PG order, goes straight. He slick shots it, takes it wide. He's hoping to do it now down to the total curve. You've got to be a brave boy to do it down there. They'll be into the Class B cars being led by Charles Wilkin shortly. Foss is closing up while these two are battling it out, slugging it out there. Foss is starting to close in the Rothmans out. He's putting on a great display, this young Belgian. Got a big fan club, all the J.G. Mulvoys and Francis, team manager here, who did so well in the Belgian 25, all here to watch him. And his girlfriend, Vanessa, they all come over to support him. And he's putting on a tremendous trot there in fourth spot. Still, Briggs hangs on there as they come up on the Hein Laudercon car. That is a wee bit down there. He went into the kiddie sand. He's got out of that now, as you see. But Class B, just to put you in the picture quickly, is Charles Wilkin leading, as did Leon Marais. 7 seconds behind him is Anthony Bulliard in a Nissan. Terry Lewis from Australia is third in a Nissan as well. Then we've got Darby Jabir in a BMW. And Duncan Foss making his way up through that pack.
Vincent Voss is lapping quicker than Michael Briggs and Janiel de Villiers. They're holding each other up because of the tussle, so Vincent Voss is certainly being able to close. And David Brabham is lapping quicker than a lot of them. He's into the 147s. So the positions from third, fourth, fifth, it's still just possible, although there's only a lap and a half to go.
Well, I think we're in for a storming finish. Certainly Voss would like to see that happen. This young Belgian, he's 23. As they hurtle down this corner, down through the Helvelin sweep into the bowl. Still Briggs is holding on there to that second position, and he's not going to give it up too easy. De Villiers has got to try everything he knows. Just to put you in the pictures, they start going into their last lap. They'll be coming across the line to start the lap the last lap in a moment or two. It's Aberdeen in the front. He's nearly 7 seconds ahead of Briggs and de Villiers. There's Michael Briggs, our champion. They're in second spot, holding on to dear life for the second position. It's definitely a problem that he's got, and the team is saying, oh, there's the whole Opel team giving him no notice, just saying one lap to go. And Foss is arriving in the picture. He's fourth. The Rothman's out. He's going very well. Brabham was fifth. He's now left Sean van der Linde by 3 seconds. Mike White is behind Sean van der Linde in seventh spot. Then we've got Henny Grunewald, a very good drive there in that that car that he's sharing with Eddie Cam, the Swiss driver, that Volkswagen Vento. We haven't seen too much of. Anthony Taylor got back into the race. There's the Reed car sitting the side of the road. He got back into the race after stalling on the line. He's intense at the moment, ahead of the class leading. There's a look at.
And Janiel is going for it. He tried to get round the outside there of Brabham, but he couldn't have... ahead of him, Michael Briggs, but he couldn't do it. He tried to put his nose through on the inside. Once a day again, the door is closed, but now he's in with a chance, is he? Getting up alongside, they're going to the left-hander, and he might just do it. They bump, and together, and Janiel is through. And Vincent Vos is also trying to get through, but this time, Mike Briggs managed to ward him off, and now Brabham is with them. This is a tremendous climax to the second race.
Absolutely, we're in for a storming finish here. De Villiers nudged his way through. Mike Briggs has roughed it up with many, many drivers in the park. Foss has got past him. Briggs has definitely got troubles. He'd be in there fighting. He's got problems getting out of those corners. Foss has gone through now. He's up into third spot, but there's problems there with the tire. Must have bumped his thing. He's just going to hang on there if that tire lasts to the end. It's rubbing the bodywork, as you can see, onto the brakes, going into the AA bowl. It's not that one. It's on the other side. It's all smoke, tire smoke. They can smell it. And Mike Briggs is holding off there. David Brabham. Brabham's going through on the inside. He's going to push him out the way. Briggs is very late. He's having a terrible finish to this race. As the winner comes through, Aberdeen, fastest lap, wins by just on it's about 7 seconds. They come through, and what have we got at the finish? Briggs going through the inside of Sean van der Linde this time. Brabham's going for Foss. Can he make it to the line? They can't. As they come through there, Foss just makes it ahead of, let's have a look there, we've got Foss ahead of van der Linde, and Brabham got through to second, to third position. Well, what a finish to that race. Chris Aberdeen the winner by 10.2 seconds in the Audi A4. Janiel de Villiers, what a drive there in that last lap. He's a second spot in the BP Nissan. Then it was David Brabham. He had to force his way through from the back of the field. He was in third spot. Vincent Foss, great drive in the Rothmans Audi. Then Sean van der Linde and Michael Briggs battling, you can see, with that motorbike.
You've got a South African crowd that's very proud of you, Chris. A great win that, but it wasn't so easy to start.
Fell off. He's another one who's got his reputation to maintain. So there's an awful lot going for these guys. Charlie Cox's gearbox split in the Class B Nissan Sentra. So apart from those, I think what we've got to look forward to is Joubert. Can he beat Bieler from the start?
3 seconds to go. The engine's up right on the rev limit at 8,000 RPM. Is the all-important start as Cleland moves to the side. He's on the right-hand side of your picture going for... He's going for Frank Bieler. Grant McCleary slots in behind them too. Joubert's on the inside. The Opels have made a tremendous start. It's Bieler, and Cleland has gone to the front, or is it Grant McCleary? Is it number four? Is it number three? We'll pick him up now as they go for the corner. And Julian Bailey, what a start by Bailey as they come into Nashua Corner on the first tour. It looks like car number four, and that is Grant McCleary has gone to the front of this race. As they come down towards us, it's McCleary, it's Bailey. Then it's Frank Bieler on his tail. He's got John Cleland. We've got Terry Moss just behind him in the Rothmans Audi. There he is. And then we've got the second of the Enviro cars coming through. There's the Class B cars. The red and white car is Leon Marais. He won the last race. As they fly through the Goodyear corner, it's John Clennon now very much in a challenging position in fourth spot there. He's got Terry Moss on his tail. And then we've got the two Enviro cars. Dion Joubert had a disastrous start to this race. The Opels have certainly learned from the last race how to get off the line quickly, because the four-wheel drive Audi should be the one that actually takes off first. It gets four wheels planted onto the tire, and then it really lets forth. It's McCleary, it's Julian Bailey in second spot in a rocket ship of a Minolta. Toyota's brought his British touring car engine over, and we've got Sakia, the Japanese driver. He's won at Le Mans, getting pushed off the road. We'll just pick up which Enviro car that is, I should imagine. It's going to be Jeff Brabham, it's McCleary, and then Bailey trying to go on the inside. Then it's Bieler in the Audi. Is he biding his time? It's run at a tremendous pace. This Bieler's running at lap record times. He set up the fastest lap here so far today, but the heat is really on. We've got a couple of changes in order. Here comes Bieler down the inside. He's put the Minota Toyota away of Julian Bailey, and Bieler's on a roll.
He is indeed, and I don't think it'll be too long before he hits the front, but he's still going to get past a very doughty South African, Grant McCleary, with everything to play for here to develop his reputation. He leads at the end of the first lap from Frank Bieler, second by a second. Julian Bailey third and running strongly, then in fourth place. That is Terry Moss. And he's looking to challenge Julian Bailey. He tries to go through on the inside, takes to the grass, but Julian Bailey just holds him off at Nashua. And in behind those two, Dion Joubert and Tim Harvey are also running strongly, but Cleland has come into the pits, so that's very bad luck for John Cleland. He's really not having the right sort of outing today here at Kyalami.
They said it was fuel pickup problems before, as you said, Brian, but it's a great pity to come all this way, because we expecting to see a lot of this British Touring Car champion. He's certainly a rugged driver and can mix it with the best of. Here's the order after the first lap. It's Terry Moss going for the inside of Dion Joubert. He's really putting the pressure on, as Grant McCleary was leading by a second on the fast two around here, ahead of the Audi A4, the world champion. Frank Bieler, Julian Bailey was next in the Minolta Toyota. Then we had Terry Moss, as you've seen him on the road. Dion Joubert, they swapping places there. Tim Harvey's in sixth spot. Marco Werner from Germany is in seventh position. Then it's Alex Guggel next with Mark De Brieger on his tail, Sabine Rick and Eddie Camp. Leading Class B, we've got Leon Murray, Charlie Cox, the Australian. It's still Grant McCleary defending his line. Those Audis can go very deep into the corners. As we said many times during these races, they've got the powers. They go for this corner. McCleary defends his line. He moves over through the AA King. Not often you can go through over that curve. It tends to send you to the outside of the corner. He's holding onto his line. Bieler's going for the inside. He can't quite do it this time. It's these 2-litre cars, all 16-valve cars. They are four-cylinder engines. Certainly in the Vectra, that's a front-wheel drive car. It's got a tremendous turn of speed down the straight. The second lap is gone. It's McCleary. Bieler's on his tail. You can see it. Bailey's moved back to third. Dion Joubert's moved up to fourth. Terry Moss is on his tail. Tim Harvey in the BP Nissan comes next in sixth position. Marco Werner, good job there. In car number 19 is in the seventh position. Out of Nashua corner, they're through this tricky section, and the heat is really on.
Yes, indeed, and here he's having to use all his local knowledge to keep Frank Bieler out. I think that he can defend and he can take a tight line for quite a long time, but sooner or later, I think the Opel Vectra is going to have to give best to the world champion. Julian Bailey doing a marvellous job in the Toyota Camry. He's really getting about the best out of that car, I think, here at Kyalami today. He's running strongly in third. But Dion Joubert now up ahead of Terry Moss. He's looking good in the BMW, and I think he might give a strong challenge in a few minutes' time. But look at that Audi up the hill into West Bank. Is he going to look at the inside? Because they're immensely strong, powering away early at the hairpin and chasing off after Grant McCleary's Opel Vectra. Good stuff from young McCleary.
As they go down the Caltech's mine shaft, just absolutely flat out. They're going through that over 200 k's an hour. And then it's onto the brakes, down through the gearbox, down three. The brakes just locking on those back wheels there. Bieler just tailing them all the way through. Two laps are gone. This is lap three. And as you said, Brian, before the races, that Audi just buys this time when it gets past. It's an awesome hand, an awesome brake and road holder, and then it just sets off and on its way. Maybe not the most powerful car in the race, though.
No, but Bieler's a cool customer. He knows precisely the performance of his car. He knows the advantages that he has over the opposition. But there's an excited pit crew there, willing Grant McCleary on to stay in front. And you can see that even Julian Bailey there is getting a chance to close the gap on the Audi, perhaps briefly, as the Audi looks for a chance to find a way past the South African.
You can see the cars get onto the outside wheels that go through Nashua. That's a very tricky corner. It's caught a lot of people out in qualifying. It certainly caught a lot of people out during the races here today. Bieler's having a look-see. He's a left-hand drive car. The Opel at the moment is a right-hand drive. It's going to be left-hand drive. The new Vectra's to balance out the engine position in the car. That's how scientific and how nitpicking they get in these modern touring cars. Bieler still keeps the pressure on. Bailey's got a quick motor car. We've never seen that Minota Toyota go that well. He's right in the hunt. Toyota's going well here in South Africa. He's pulled them up during the year since his arrival here. He's really done a great job of sorting out. But his British touring car motor, Joubert, has still got Moss on his tail. There's Harvey on his own just behind him. He's got Marco Werner. It's Alex Guggel was just behind. Sabine Rick is behind them in ninth spot.
You know, it's very interesting, Roger, that the fastest lap so far anyway has gone to Terry Moss in the Audi 80. And they were telling me only a moment ago in the Audi pit that That 80 is as quick as the A4 in a straight line. And so it just shows it's a good performing car. They've got it well sorted. And Terry has really capitalized on that today.
Well, he's put in a great performance. He's an aggressive driver. And I don't think we've ever doubted the speed of it. I don't think it had quite the handling or the aerodynamics of the A4. No doubt about it. It's the benchmark car at the moment. There's going to be two of those cars in South Africa. All these teams, the only team we're not having in this racing next year in South Africa is the Ford. I think Ford Mondeos have decided to just sort their scene out there with the Mondeos. But Nissan is going to be in there strong. They're still doing well here. Tim Harvey lying in sixth position. The pit boards come out. There's the order. It's McCleary. We've had four laps. A third of this race is gone. We've got eight laps or just on 33, 34 kilometers of this race to go. Beeler's second. 0.6 of a second in arrears. Bailey, Sir, the Minotto, Camry. Jabez there with hanging on to his tail. He's got Moss. You can see that Rothman's out. He's right in there. Harvey's in sixth spot. And Marco Werner.
You've got five cars separated by just 2 seconds. This is stunning stuff. And it is interesting that Bieler has not found a way past the Opel Vectra so far. But look at Joubert. He's closing right up on Bailey. And there is just this question in my mind whether the Toyota will last the pace in terms of ultimate pace, or whether the BMW will, as the race develops, be able to get past. Front-wheel drive cars, bit harder on their tyres than the rear-wheel drive BMW.
Onto the shelf at West Bank they go. We're in lap number five. Still Grant McCleary in the lead. Bieler taking a tighter line down that second left-hander. It's a double left-hander. Now they go down the mine shaft. Nothing in performance there. Has the Opel got a little bit more? Maybe it's got a K an hour as they go down the Celtics mine shaft. Absolutely flat out. Over 205 Ks an hour on the floorboards. They go in there. Bieler's going to go wide and slingshot it. McCleary defends his line on the inside. He's trying to get more power on the outside. McCleary's got the better line as he goes up to the AA King. He's got a tighter line. He's been allowed to go into the corner first. Bieler's hanging there, but still in his mirrors. It's full of a blue motor car, the Minotto Toyota there of Julian Bailey. And that, we've never seen it as close as this up in the front. Oh, mind you, we say that every time. We have close racing like this every time. And when we get the next race like it, we tend to think it's always that close.
This is really great. Oh, dear. And that is the Rothmans Audi 80 out of the race. And so Terry Moss really disappointed with that. He's been running so well. But full marks to Grant McCleary. Or, yes, there he is, still ahead of Frank Bieler. And he has demonstrated a real cool head under immense pressure from the world champion. That is an impressive drive. Still he's ahead. Now then, Julian Bailey, he's even beginning to look at the possibility of catching up and making a move on Bieler. No, it's not really on. Because look, there we can see the gap. And now Bieler concentrating on finding a way past Grant McCleary, whilst Dion Joubert looks for a way past Julian Bailey to take third place.
There was talk in the pits, of course, when the Audis get into traffic, they'd make it difficult for them to pass. Because they go deep into the corner, they've got traffic ahead, of course, they lose that bit of advantage that they do have. But once they get in the front, then they tend to just clear off in the front. Oh, dear. And that's the Japanese driver, Masanori Sekiya, going very wide around Goodyear Corner.
That's the alternative route, isn't it, Roger?
Yes, he is. He's keeping it on the grass. He's keeping that motor car going as he heads off towards the Rothmans S's there. And the little Volkswagen Vento Jetta comes past. It's been well driven, that car. I must say, it's been in the picture here. Class B has been led by Leon Marais. Charlie Cox is 11 seconds behind. His domination there by that Toyota. Saul McCleary in front. We're coming up to the end of lap six. He's defending his line as he goes up to the AA King. Goes over to take his line. It's a very tricky corner, that. Bailey's looking for a way through. If you make one mistake, you're going to have another few cars getting past you. He's trying for the inside. Has he got him? He goes, as we say, late into the corner. The door was open just a wee bit. And look at Bailey. Bailey's gone through. This is what we're saying. One little mistake, or just open the door by a fraction, and the others are through. Look at them come past the pit. Bailey's now going for the front. If Toyota could pull this off against an Audi, what a victory that would be for them.
I tell you, Julian Bailey's growing horns right now, because he's got the bit between his teeth, and he is flying. A lovely strategic maneuver there. He could see that Grant was defending his line, the Audi was committed, and he thought, thank you very much, I'll follow in behind you, and he was through enough into second place. Grant, in my view, a little bit unlucky to be back in third place right now, but he's got Joubert to think about as well, because these are the two local rivals, both South African boys, and there's a matter of pride, surely, Roger, in who finishes ahead.
Sorry, guys.
There's a matter of pride as to
absolutely
who finishes
they've
ahead.
They've been at it the whole year. Joubert actually, in the last race of this championship year, they went in with even points into the last race, and Dion actually won it
with Grant McCleary in second position. But the heat is on. Here's a little bit further back.
That's Tim Harvey.
And Jeff Brabham. That's Nick Duval and Jeff Brabham, in fact.
Ah.
As they go down through that corner, Nick is back in action. He went off in some oil in the earlier race onto the West Bank shelf. We've had six laps. We're in lap seven at the moment. The order, as you see it, world champion Frank Beeler, the RDA four in front. Julian Bailey in the Minolta Camrys in second spot. It's Grant McCleary in the Opel Vectra third. Dion Jabeli, you see him in your picture now. The Enviro car in fourth spot. A little bit further back, they're 5 seconds in arrears. Is Tim Harvey and Marco Werner has moved up. He's coming up nicely. The first four cars are covered by 0.6 of a second. As you see, there's nothing in it. You can't get racing much closer than this. And the touring car racing is really providing great action here at the Grand Prix circuit this afternoon. It's Bailey now. He's too far away from the Bieler car. This is where we said it's going to clear off in front. No traffic and get into corners very late and out very early. But Bailey's race is not over yet. The others are going to be on his tail as they all tear down past the pits. They're coming at us 205 to 210 kilometers now. Brave drivers going down through those total curves at those sort of speeds. You can see right to the edge of that road. If they go off there, here's a tricky one now. They slip and slide their way through, down through the box. Jabeer lost it there. He must have missed a gear change or he just froze for a moment. He's lost his toe from McCleary. So now he's got to really fight as we're in lap eight at the moment. Seven laps are gone. Five laps to go. It's Bieler. It's Bailey, McCleary. Probably not finished with him yet. Then it's Jabeer. Here's Tim Harvey now. Good, putting up a good performance. Marco Werner, Daytona 25 winner, prominent in Porsche Super Cups. The next car of their stable comes along. Alex Guggel. Sabine Reck is along there as well. He's getting through some of the slower, the back markers there. As they come up the hill, it is still the Toyota being followed there by Grant McCleary. That Toyota has got a rocket of a motor. When he came back with that for our last race here at Kyalami, it really comes out of corners.
Yeah, I think Julian Bailey is going to be well pleased with this performance as long as it survives. I noticed his last lap was a 147.818. Now, that is actually a second a lap, 1.1 seconds slower than Frank Bieler. But I think we can say he's the best of the rest at the moment and certainly is flying as they go past the back marker. I'm still just a little bit concerned about the ability of the Toyota to run the full pace on the tyres. And maybe if Grant, whilst he was under so much pressure from Frank Bieler, he might have had to eat into his tyre reserves. And it'll be interesting to see how that, those two positions develop during the race.
It's all about tyres. It's Dunlop tyres on the Audi, it's Michelin tyres on the other. And it's essential that you actually preserve your tyres. This locking of the wheels going into corners, overdriving it through corners. At these great speeds, these guys are doing a tremendous job. It can just take the edge off your tyres and you can't come back. Your car starts to understeer. You just can't get at the man ahead of you. You see Bailey now sliding his way. He's starting to lock wheels. He's starting to, as you say, Brian, and he's got to preserve what he's got. Bieler's not too far ahead, mind you. It's 1.2 seconds.
What is a feature? What is a feature is I think that we can see that Dion Joubert has dropped back a bit. He's dropped back by over 3 seconds from Grant McCleary. So that will give Grant the opportunity to use his car just that little bit more effectively.
He hasn't got the pressure from the from his on his back boot, but he's got Bailey ahead of him. He's certainly trying very hard. You've got to make the most of those tyres. And when we say tyres go off, it means they overheat the tyres and they start to lose their grip. And they slick tyres. You're watching motor racing for the first time. There's no tread in them at all. They depend on these compounds. They have different compounds for different tracks and different lengths of races. But here they're going into the back markers.
And of course, they depend much on heat. They have to have the right amount of heat in the tires. If they get too hot, they go off. And if they're too cool, they don't run quickly as well.
At the end of lap eight, Bieler, Frank Bieler, that's in your picture now, is 1.2 seconds ahead of that man. The Minolta Toyota being well driven there by Julian Bailey. Here comes Grant McCleary, once past Charlie Cox, the Australian, who's in that Nissan. He goes wide to get him on the way down to the AA King. A little further behind, we've got the Bielt car there, Ferdy DeVos. Here he comes, putting up a good drive. He gets taken there by Dion Joubert. We've got Tim Harvey coming here. Marco Werner starting to close on him. He's not too far behind. He's bringing his teammate, having their best drive this weekend. Alex Guggel is just on his tail. There's Sabine Reck, and there is Jeff Brabham. Not too happy. He doesn't seem to be with that car.
No, Jeff, I don't think, has been happy all weekend. He said about this morning's race that he fell off. There were no excuses in trying to overtake somebody else. And He just went in a bit too quick, too tight, and he fell off, so he had no excuses to offer. But he's never really looked comfortable in that car all weekend. So I think the Australian champion certainly having a lot of hard work to do here and going away unrewarded.
Sabine Rick, of course, has come on very well this year. She's just ahead of him. There she is in that white motor car.
She's a fabulous lady. She's got such a nice personality.
Wonderful for the touring cars, really is. And she's got faster and faster all the time. She's got a 95 car. There she is. And she's being followed at the moment by Jeff Brabham, Australian champion, of course, from the famous Brabham brothers, Sir Jack Brabham, the father. And Sabine is holding off the gentleman.
Four times winner of the IMSA GTP Championship in America, Jeff. And really very talented driver. Made a lot of money over in the United States.
Interesting one there about Sabine. She actually, grew up at Adenau, which is down at the bottom of the Nürburgring. Yeah. So she's been steeped in this motor racing with her family. And she's heard racing motor cars all her life. And she really does go well. She's married to an orthodontist who follows her at all her races around South Africa. Right, the Class B leader, that's Leon Moraes, just been overtaken by the leader. Leon doing a sterling job. He's 14 seconds ahead of the car of Charlie Cox, who shares it with Duncan Voss. Moraes, of course, shares it with Charles Wilk, and they've won the first two Class B races. Still the heat is on. We're coming up to the end of lap 10. Not far to go.
No, and in fact, interesting, the gap between second and third. Julian Bailey and Grant McCleary just separated by 0.7 of a second. And that really is encouraging for Grant because he's running strongly with just two laps to go. And he's definitely in with a chance of being second. It would be a feather in his cap if he could get past this guy in the Minolta Toyota Carina, Toyota Camry, old habits die hard.
Well, slipping and sliding his way through down Nashua. That's a tricky one. Glad to get through that one. They use all the road and the triple and the ripple concrete. This is a close race. Bieler is 2.9 seconds ahead in the first race. He finished the race just on 6 seconds ahead. So whether he's cooling it and just playing it from the front is another question, of course.
He may well be being conservative in order to preserve the car for Chris Aberdeen in the fourth race of the day. These cars are working hard here today, so he's got to win by a small margin.
Right, Brabham's now got past Sabine Rick. He's just slipped past her there. There he is now. That's Jeff Brabham, the older brother of David Brabham, who did so well in race number two. Oh dear. That's Nick Duval is getting pushed into the pits, or is that Tim Harvey?
It's our number Nick, six. Nick Duval.
It's Nick. Unfortunately, it's been a two no finishes for Nick today, and that's a great pity. And then they've parked that car after that great performance. Janelle de Villiers and all the excitement, they've had to retire the car. He went off in the first race. The battle continues for second spot. Tires are off now. There's bits and pieces of bodywork hanging off as well. Those cars have been in the water today. It's hard driving. Beale is starting to open up a gap this time. We'll be going into the final lap now. It's going to be the final lap. And it's all got to happen on this lap. That's Nick Duval getting out. Two known finishes. He went off the road in the oil. It was dropped by another car, the Keith car. Here comes Grant McCleary. Through in third spot. Bieler goes into his last lap. The gap, he's opened it now. He's just almost leading as he pleases. He's gone up to 4.7 seconds. It was 6 seconds in the first race. Grant McCleary is just on a second behind Julian Bailey. That's the gap at the moment as they hurry up to Nashua.
I get the impression that Julian's going to survive because although I could see his car struggling to retain grip at one stage, it seems to me that he's looking fairly safe there, unless Grant has got something in his locker that we haven't seen yet.
I think in both cases here, the tyres have just cried enough. They've tried so hard in the beginning, that sort of racing. We've got Class B, it's been led by Leon Moraes again, Charlie Cox behind him. He's from Australia, as we say, Ferdy De Vos, and the Bielt car just behind him. And then we've got Merman Gunter and Nico van Rensburg. He's having a very good outing in the Nissan. In the front, it's on the last lap. We've got half a lap to go. Frank Bieler, world champion from the World Cup Series held in Paul Ricard. This is going to be second win of the day. Second and third will go to that blue Toyota just climbing up Rothmans onto the West Bank shelf. Those cars still at full stretch. We're up to 8,000.
I noticed Julian Bailey's lap time there was 1:47.948. He's the quickest of the rest, there's no doubt, still at this stage. But Frank Bieler's just taken the fastest lap at 1:46.201 from his teammate, well, not exactly teammate, but from Terry Moss. So Bieler has really had a tremendous outing at Kyalami. He got to know the circuit when he did all the test driving earlier this year, tire testing and so on. and he's used it to good advantage. And of course, because he's been able to lead from the front, as it were, he hasn't had to worry about the opportunities and where he can first get past. So, making it two in a row, coming up to the flag. It's the world champion and twice winner at Kyalami, Frank Bieler in the Audi A4, doing a wonderful job. From Julian Bailey, second in the Minolta Toyota Camry, and in third place, an excellent result for young Grant McCleary in his Vec. Fourth place, Dion Joubert. Fifth was number 7, Tim Harvey in the Nissan Sentra. And sixth, number 19, a good finish for Marco Werner. The Class B win was taken by number 40, Leon Marais, from
two races. And this is the final race. It's going to be over 12 laps, 50 kilometers of the AA Grand Prix circuit here at Kyalami. There's Briggs, they're ready to go. It's down to the final 5 seconds. The revs are up to 8,500 where they're limited. Smoke, tire smoke, and they're away there. The start is so important. Briggs has got a good one. He's on his way down. Those Opals are making tremendous starts with their front wheel drive. There goes Brabham. As the rest of the field go by, the technical man, Dick Sorensen, watches him out onto the circuit. It's Briggs. It's Chris Aberdeen. Then it is number one is Sean van der Linde. Then we have got the first of the Nissans, and that should be, I should imagine,
Giniel de Villiers, I think, and he wants as good a race as he had last time. Stunning race.
He sure does. He put in a tremendous performance, probably the best driver of the year, and he's really starting to mix it with some of these top international drivers. We've got 14 South Africans. It's weighted in favor of the South Africans as Brabham starts making up the places, passing those Class B cars. There are 7 international drivers at the moment. In the last race, it was South Africans first and second. David Brabham, the Australian, came home in third spot from way down on the grid. Anthony Rea, unfortunately, out of a drive this time. The car gave mechanical problems. Right in the into the Toyota now. That's done all the winning in the first three races. That white and red one, there it is now. It's only coming second in Class B. Duncan Foss, who's the man who won the championship, the Class B championship, is in front. They've changed the gearbox on the car. Charlie Cox, Australian, did very well the last time to come home in second position. It's the Opel in front, the Vectra. Michael Briggs, the South African touring car champion. Twice in 3 years he's won it. He's ahead there. Aberdeen's in second spot. Then we have got Sean van der Linde. Hello. And going right side, Mike White. Oh, and they're starting to bump and barge each other into. Oh, that's going to be major damage on that BMW. Just have a look on the number of that car when the dust clears, which
I
one it is.
I think that's Wolfgang Hoog. Yeah, no, it's not. It's the other one then.
It's Marco De Santos. He can't believe it. That's the second time out of two races. This very talented young driver.
Well, David Brabham is already beginning to move up the field, but he's got a lot of work to do. And so Mike Briggs, with an excellent start to this final race of the day in the AA Fleet Care Super Touring category. Mike Briggs in the lead, but Chris Aberdeen has the comfort of knowing that he's got the ability to be able to go past. Sean van der Linde told me before the race that he wanted to go for it. Give it everything.
Well, Mike White coming across there. Marco De Santos gets the worst of that. He bounces up into there. He's heading straight for that Armco rally. What a biff. That's going to do serious damage to that chassis. And that's the retirement from both races by Marco De Santos. That car finished in sixth position in the last race in the half of Marco Werner, the German.
Certainly Craig Baird looking good in fifth place.
Right, Mike White is getting out of the car too. He must have done terminal damage to his motor car. That's a bad end to his day. It was a pity, but they all got locked together, and that is him out of it at the moment. Taylor at the moment, their sister car is lying in seventh spot. The Castrol Toyota Camry. Still it is Briggs, it is Bieler, as you see there. Sean van der Linde in third. Then we've got Janiel de Villiers. Craig Baird, the New Zealander, four times the touring car champion. And Vincent Foss from Belgium. He's lying in sixth position at the moment, got fourth in his last race.
Craig Baird, who had an unfortunate first race, is up there just ahead of Vincent Voss in pace. And look at him now, challenging Janiel de Villiers for that fourth.
Very well, I must say, Sabine Rick did a good race. They've been shot as 44 as the entry. Pressure there from Janiel de Villiers at Craig Baird. He wants to finish Andy Taylor. Vincent has moved back a position. Tiffel in the other BP is just there in eighth. David Brabham from the back grid. Just as you say, Brunner charge.
In the bit now up to ninth. The Class B cars going through.
And it's his own motor car, Leon Moreno, Charles Wilkin now. The car one has won three races here this afternoon in that car in Class B category. And look on his tail, he has got Heinrich Gahn, another second champion, who flies in that Motorbilt Jetta, going up in the front.
We've had two lap two on lap three now. It's Briggs. He wants to win this more than anything else. He wants that Opel to win to finish the season. This is the Grand McLeary car he's driving at the moment.
There is something important to remember. They're on new tyres, and that might just give the Opel Vectra a little bit of opportunity in the early stages of the race. Let's see whether or not it can actually last. I think that the Audi's got a lot in reserve.
Tyres are playing a big part in this race. Of course, the talk is that the Dunlops on the Audis, the only cars that use the Dunlop tyres, the Audis, are on their World Cup rubber. That's softer, seems to suit this shorter racing, whereas all the other cars in Michelin are on the normal tyres they use in the other races. And, oh, that's Briggs out. Now, a wheel has come loose. He must have hit a curb or a tyre. We'll just see that car if we get a little bit closer. He'll try to get up to the pitch very quickly. Well, that's his race run. Aberdeen has come through in first position. Briggs is not going to stay in second. Sean van der Linde has gone to second now. And Aberdeen's in front. There's Sean van der Linde. We'll have to see whether he's able to challenge the Audi. Good performance by this young man from Paul. He's just 23. As Aberdeen powers it out of Dasher corner. But van der Linde starting to look good. Here comes Briggs now. Taking the tyre down. That was the problem. He hit that tyre on the way in. And that just destroyed that wheel. Goes across the curb. And he's got to make his way into the pits as quickly as possible. Let's see if he gets back on the road. We hope he hasn't done suspension devil. But that destroyed that wheel. It's such a fine line. You've got no, he's out of it. Michael Briggs is out of the race. Well, that's a great pity. That's the South African touring car champion. And it was just taking that tight line through there. I think he just nicked that heavy tyre that's there to mark that curb. We've had three laps. We're on lap four at the moment. Aberdeen in front. Sean van Linde starting to give chase. He's taken up the chase. Janiel de Villiers has got Craig Baird. Very competitive on his tail. That's that white BMW. Vincent Foss has moved up to fifth spot in the Audi from Belgium. There's the damage. It really, it was serious. It must have given that tyre very hard clobber, that wheel, and it's just bent it out of it.
It looks to me as though it had some other impact, not just from the curb. And I think if you look at the damage on the bodywork surrounding the wheel, it suggests that maybe there was impact with something else at an earlier stage. Then he hit the curb and the wheel let go.
Well, that's a pity now, but the man that we're depending on to give chase to Aberdeen is Sean van der Linde. He'll really be charged up. His season has not been the best after winning in 94. He seemed to have a very bad, and of course that tremendous bang he had at Swartkop. So he's on the charge. Baird is hanging on to de Villiers for dear life.
The BMW is actually running well because David Brabham's got the fastest lap at the moment, 147.095. And certainly Craig Baird is right on the tail of Janiel de Villiers. But nobody really can catch this man, Chris Aberdeen, in the Audi A4. Really does look immensely strong. But what a splendid performance by Sean van der Linde. He's the BMW once again, the Envirocar BMW, looking strong. The gap is only a second, and it's been stable like that for a lap or more.
They were saying down in the Audi pit that the Opel leading the leading Frank Bieler for six laps was the first time Frank Bieler has ever been led by an Opel in his life. He had to come to South Africa to have it happen. We're on four laps. David Brabham was ninth the last lap. On the last lap, he's now in seventh position, and he's going. And I think he's actually gone to sixth. He's gone into, he's taken over from Tiff Nadell, who was in sixth. So Brabham has gone up to sixth. He's making rapid progress.
This is wonderful to watch, actually, because David has had such a poor season in the British Championship. They really have struggled to qualify in the top 10. Best positions, a couple of fourths. But now he's on a charge, a big, big charge. There's number six, Tiff Nadell. Tiff, who really had an unfortunate first race, wants to finish and finish strongly. He's in sixth, but or is he now back into seventh place? Because Brabham is past him. So David Brabham now up there into sixth.
But here comes Brabham now, uses the centre of the road. Normally a wider line used on the AA Bell corner. They start coming up the hill towards the AA kink. Here they come now. It's a very tricky one, this. Kyalami's a driver circuit, which these drivers certainly love.
And just ahead of him, Vincent Vos, so there's an opportunity to make progress. The gap is only perhaps a second or so, maybe a couple of seconds between Brabham as they cross the line at the end of five laps.
And there we have it. He's down 2.7 seconds is Brabham behind Vos. You can see on the road, that's the Rothmans Audi. They had a gearbox go on one of the shafts broke in the gearbox of the Terry Moscow, which he's sharing with Vincent Vos, the Belgian, as he did in the 24-hour race, I'm sure we've told you earlier this afternoon. But here's the battle just behind. Nadell Wolfgang, how is it? Now that's Baird, I beg your pardon. Yes. That is de Villiers, it's Baird. Foss is there, and here comes Brabham on a charge. The leader's gone through. Aberdeen, Sean van der Linde. We've got Craig Baird is ever present under his back wing. He's not far behind at all. Whether he's going to be able to get through, we'll have to wait to see. Foss has now got Brabham closing in. If he looks in his mirror, there's Vincent Foss, the Belgium. And in the pits, we've got Wayne Taylor. Well, that's the charge finished there by the Toyota team after a great performance there with Julian Bailey today.
Yes, yes indeed. Now, this really is a stunning battle. It's a battle of tactics here between Craig Baird and Janiel de Villiers. And Janiel, he's had such a good day today. He's not going to give in easily. It's important for his career. But Craig Baird really wants to get ahead of him, and he's got to go some, because Vincent Voss is closing up in the Audi 80. He's right in behind them, and right behind him is David Brabham as well. We're going to have a four-car battle for these top places now, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth.
Well, we all remember that tremendous tussle in that last lap. I think it's warming up to a real storming finish at the end of this race. We're coming up to the end of lap six. That's the middle distance of this race, the 12-lapper. They'll have done 25 kilometers of this race, just over 25 k's now. They've got another 25 to do, and things are starting to happen. Lots of pit signals going out, instructions going to these drivers, preserve your tires. Taylor's gone back onto the circuit again, so Anthony Taylor is back in action, albeit down in 14th position. Let's just update you at the halfway mark. There's one of the B-class cars, as Sean van der Linde comes through. That's number 34, and that is Darby Joubert, just giving way to some of those faster cars. Here we go, Janiel de Villiers, Baird, and Foss are determined. Vincent Foss is on a charge. He's going to bring Brabham along with him shortly. Let's see where Brabham is. Watch him around the Goodyear sweep. There he comes now. Got to just get that a little bit closer. But this could be holding him up, Brian, and allowing Brabham to get a lot closer.
Well, the gap at the end of the last lap was 2.3 seconds between Vincent Voss and David Brabham. Looks as though David has stopped actually closing that gap. Be interesting to watch it, because he's certainly gone very quickly in the early stages of the lap. That may just have held a price, taken a price. Oh, look at Voss having a go there on the inside of Craig Baird. And if he can hold it there on the exit of Wesbank, then I think he may well be through. The car is supposed to be quick, but is that Baird holding him off? And he's done it. Now that was good competitive stuff. I thought that Voss ought really to have been able to carry the speed down the line, and he's through now as they go through a bowl.
It's just what we say, these Audis are able to go right up to the apex of the corner on their brakes. They can turn in with the brakes on, and that's a big advantage. A gap, get into that apex, and they're on their bicycle. Certainly haven't got the speed as we saw down the mine shaft there, where the Audi just hasn't got that acceleration of that BMW. Right, the next problem for Foss is de Villiers. This might be a different kettle of fish for him. Finished seven laps. Just give you an update quickly. Seven laps are gone. Chris Aberdeen leads by 3.3 seconds. It's a bit of a doddle for him too. It's going to be four wins for this World Championship winning Audi A4. Sean van der Linde is second in the Envirocar BMW. Third is Janiel de Villiers, as you see him going through now in the BP Nissan. And charging hard is Vincent Foss, the Rothmans Audi. And behind him, the New Zealander Craig Baird. And David Brabham is in sixth position. Taylor's back in the pits. That's bad news for the Toyota camp. In Class B, Duncan Foss is leading Charles Wilkin. He hasn't been beaten in many years, Charles Wilkin. He's leading by 0.7 of a second. There they are. Hard at it. The three of them are locked in battle. Hein Lodekon is just behind Wilkin as well. This is a battle second to none going on in Class B. They haven't got the wheel sizes. They haven't got the tire rubber. They haven't got the performance. But they certainly putting on a great show. It's Foss comes through. Then it's Charles Wilkin, the red and white one. The Bankfin cars, Charles Wilkin. He's going for the front. He's just half a car length behind. Then we've got Hein Lodekon, another South African champion, just behind him. Darby just back. And then that is the whole B-class field at the moment. Foss, Wilkin, Lodekon, and Darby Joubert. We caught a glimpse of him a little earlier. But down the hills they come. There's Taylor's car now in the pits. They're all looking around. It's not going to go too much further. He's still sitting in the car, hoping things can be done. They've got the laptop out to do the management system of the motor car. The laptop will tell them what they need to adjust or what's gone wrong in the motor car. But it's a bit of a lengthy business in a short race like this. We've been going for just over 14 minutes. We're coming up to the end of eight laps. We've got four laps to go. And that Audi is right on his tail this time. He was 1.1 seconds behind the last time. And he's closed right up. You don't have to tell the time this time. He's right there with him. He is just on 0.5 of a second. behind the Janiel de Villiers car. And Taylor now has finally decided to retire from the race. The car's been pulled out, been pushed into it, but Sir Anthony Taylor out of this one. Pressure there for Janiel de Villiers. The tyres are starting to lock up as well, so he's really trying hard.
Yes, I think we were expecting that because Vincent Voss is using the Audi, uses its tyres very effectively as well, and it's quick through the corners. So he's driving well. Craig Baird is being caught, by the way, by David Brabham. It's down to less than a second. They're just behind. So there's still a lot of racing left in the final four laps of the race. And there goes Voss through on the inside. And yes, he sees off de Villiers in very fine form there, looking very strong indeed. And I think now we'll see him pull away. That will leave us with de Villiers battling it out with Craig Baird and David Brabham again. So it's looking like a very good Audi day. The question is, can Vincent Voss catch Sean van der Linde for second place?
And he's going to have a very good try. There's van der Linde just ahead of him. At the moment, he's lying on 3 seconds ahead. This is lap nine at the moment. I must say, we just 25 minutes ago, that car of Vincent Voss was in pieces. All the Rothmans people around it, they were changing the gearbox, hoping to get the car. But there it is, top condition. It's moved now, up third position. Great performance by this young man from Belgium. And de Villiers is not going to let him go. Baird, just a little way behind, is being worried there by Brabham. Oh, overdoing it there. And that was Sean van der Linde. He's under pressure. He sees them in the mirrors. That white and blue Rothmans Audi is on a charge. And this race is from over.
Well, it's nearly over for Chris Aberdeen because he's still looking very strong and good. But Sean van der Linde made a definite mistake there. And with Voss and still Janiel de Villiers right on his tail, Janiel hasn't given up in the little Nissan. He really is having a very good day. And then behind them, Craig Baird with right on his tail, David Brabham. Brabham determined to get ahead and be the first of the overseas BMWs home, even if he can't catch Sean van der Linde.
We've almost forgotten about Chris Aberdeen. We've finished nine laps. We're on lap 10 at the moment. Just a 2.5 laps to go. He's on out on his own. Is Aberdeen 5.5 seconds ahead. But the battle goes on for second. This is it. We're in for a storming finish, that's for sure. Aggressive drivers, all of them champions in their own rights, in their own countries, have come out for this AA Fleet Care International Touring Car Race. And they're putting on a great show. Down this very big S-bend, the Rothmans S is downhill. You say unique in motor racing. You go left, you go down, and then you turn right, and then you're up the Rothmans Hill onto the shelf at West Bank. You do all your braking and changing down on the shelf. A little bit of oil has been put down there previously, and Voss is on a charge. He's really going down there. Aberdeen's way on his own in the front there, as it's Sean van der Linde has now got Voss on his tail. Vincent Voss and Terry Moss almost rhymes, but they've done a great job in that car today. Here he comes, he's taking another line. He wants to drive out of the corner. Has he got the power of the BM? Van der Linde's tyres might be starting to go off. It's unusual for the BMs actually to go off. They're being rear-wheel driving. He's gone for it. He's starting to make this look too easy.
He is it in him stuff from Vincent Voss. I was noticing that the lap times were pretty competitive. David Brabham has still got the fastest lap at 146.915, and he really has been consistently quick. But Vincent Voss is matching his speed as well. And so there's still a lot left, even though we've only got a lap and a half to go, or maybe just under two laps. There is Voss in the Rothmans Audi 80. I must say that he's impressed me this weekend more than I've seen him in the past racing in Britain and in Europe.
I think the circuit also suits him, and he's got a nice feeling in that team. He fits in there very well.
But look at this stream of cars, Roger.
Fantastic. This is for second spot. Voss moving over. He's going to take that title line. He said, if you want to go around the outside, try if you like. Closes the door, holds the inside. Now he's got to move over to the other side of the road. I don't think you can have the... we take his line through. That's a bit of a chance taking there, opening the door like that.
Now Brabham is ahead of Baird, so we've got the two BMWs together. Janiel is in third place. This is building up to a superlative last lap. Let's hope it stays all the way like this to the checkered flag.
Absolutely. There's Brabham now stalking after Sean van der Linde. Baird just behind in that white and red checkered BMW. Voss now is in that second position. De Villiers is third with those BMWs all over him as they pass. Is it Darby Jabir? We've got a lap and a half to go in this race. They're going to be going to their last lap shortly, and it's going to be, as we say, it's going to be some finish. That's still Voss. Janiel de Villiers hasn't given up. And Brabham, number two. Dave Brabham overdid it there. He didn't have brakes to start this race. He doesn't seem to have brakes now. He locked them up. He's lost his position and where he's going to be able to get back. I'm interested to see.
I think he was very anxious to get a hole ahead of Sean van der Linde, and he took a rather strange line there, and he paid the price for it. And that means that Craig Baird has got ahead of him again. So these
Baird said, thank you very much. You got a bonus through that one. And Foss now, let's hope he doesn't take the luxury of these lines. He'll have to defend his line. He's got de Villiers now on his tally. Have to drive defensively. He's got to keep him out. If he's going to get a great second position, it's going to be 1 and 2 for Audi. And we haven't seen those for years, except when it was raining. And they'd come home using that four-wheel drive that they have, the all-wheel drive, as they call it in the Quattro. There's Foss in second. We've got half a lap to go. Just a half a lap to go. It's Foss in second. There's the leader now. Not too far ahead of them, actually. There they all are. There they come, the blue and white one, the Rothmans out. He's a second. There comes Janiel de Villiers. I think he's given up the chase. But Sean van der Linde is there. Craig Baird, Dave Brabham now. Unfortunately, he blew it there, as you say, just trying to be an opportunist. It didn't work for him. It could have, but it didn't. And he didn't have any brakes, remember. Just about 21 minutes ago, they were trying to find him some brakes. So he's put in a tremendous performance. All to the grid. He started badly today, stalled in his first race. As they come past Duncan Foss, he's leading Class B. Look, they're still there. Lotterkans on his tail. Where's the Charles Wilkins car? We don't see him. Is he going ahead, Charles Wilkins? Not his third in the class. We haven't seen him beat in any motor race for many years. But here comes the leader now. Chris Aberdeen's on his way to the line.
Chris Aberdeen, I must say, he's impressed me here today in the Audi. He's taken full advantage of it, and he deserves his two victories. He's used a car which is clearly superior to go out there and improve his own reputation. And I think that he can be well pleased. But what a stunning race behind him. Anyway, Chris Aberdeen coming through Gestetner for the last time and up to the line to take victory. You can see him punching the air. The checkered flag waves. The team are delighted as he takes the flag. In second place, it is Vincent Voss from Belgium. Third is Janiel de Villiers in the Nissan. Fourth, Sean van der Linde in the BMW. Fifth, Craig Baird in his BMW. Sixth, David Brabham. And then in a Class B car, Duncan Voss takes victory from Heinrich Lattergan. And then Charles Wilkin is third.
Get the Citizen Motoring every...